One topic that's come up a lot over recent months is the growing debate between decentralized finance, DeFi, and centralized finance, CeFi. But what are differences between the two? And what do they share in common? And could we one day see elements of CeFi and DeFi merge? We'll cover it all in this latest edition of your Crypto Capsule Explainer Series. Hope you're ready, because here we go. This episode is brought to you by Bullish. Bullish is a powerful new digital asset exchange built for institutions that combines the innovations of DeFi with the regulation of more traditional finance. Follow Bullish on Twitter or visit bullish.com to learn more. Please always remember that this is not investment advice and that digital assets and cryptocurrencies are high-risk products. Consult your professional advisor before dealing in them. Bullish's services are available in select locations only and not to U.S. persons. Visit bullish.com for important information and risk warnings. Traditional finance as we know it is defined by centralization. There's a core set of institutions we all use and that all of your financial activity goes through. When you send a payment to a friend, you need to go to a traditional bank or payments platform. When you want to get a mortgage, you need to go through your bank. When you want to invest in stocks, you need to work through a broker or a brokerage platform. But Bitcoin, for the first time, allowed us to send value to each other without going through an intermediary. Yet ironically, despite the decentralized nature of the cryptocurrency ecosystem, the majority of crypto transactions and crypto trades today still take place on centralized intermediaries, from buying crypto on a crypto exchange to safeguarding your assets with a custodian. So while the asset may be decentralized, the transactions involving the asset take place using centralized players. And it's important to understand that there are fundamental differences between centralized finance and decentralized finance. For instance, CeFi, or centralized finance, is a delivery of financial services via centralized intermediaries like a centralized crypto exchange. A centralized crypto exchange, for example, is a legal entity complete with physical offices and customer support teams. They have standardized KYC policies and are often regulated. Exchanges like Coinbase, Binance, and Crypto.com are all examples of centralized exchanges. In addition, from a trading perspective, centralized exchanges also have a central order book that allows us to see the bids and asks, basically a fancy term for the prices that people are happy to buy and sell a certain type of crypto asset, and then match those buyers and sellers. To ensure there's always liquidity, which is a fancy way of saying that there's always buyers and sellers, entities called market makers provide liquidity to such exchanges by buying and selling different assets, thus ensuring that there's always a buyer when you're looking at selling. Such market makers obviously profit by conducting such activity by making a tiny spread on each transaction. While such centralized exchanges tend to be more user-friendly, the downside, however, is that every user has to contend with counterparty risk, meaning if the exchange goes bust, your funds could be at risk. Also, if you leave your assets on such an exchange, you may lose them if the exchange gets hacked. Now, DeFi, or decentralized finance, on the other hand, is different. DeFi allows us to use some of the inherent attributes of blockchain technology to completely reinvent finance, so we can conduct financial transactions without needing to rely on centralized intermediaries and only relying on smart contracts, which are basically contracts that are written in code and available for anyone to see. If the conditions quoted in the smart contract are met, then the transaction is automatically executed without any human intervention. Uniswap, Aave, and SushiSwap are all examples of decentralized exchanges. Unlike centralized exchanges, most DeFi exchanges have no office, no customer support, are not regulated, nor require KYC or any other type of client identification. While this permissionless nature has advantages, like allowing anyone, anywhere to come and trade, it also has downsides, like not knowing whom you're trading with. And this can lead to some unintended consequences. For example, regulated entities need to know who their counterparties are, and they can only trade with entities that also conduct KYC and AML checks. In addition, while there's no counterparty risk, as you're not facing a centralized exchange, there's always smart contract risk, like a bug in the code that a bad actor could exploit. Also, DeFi exchanges tend to be more complicated to use, as users need to be comfortable with using wallets and the intricacies of crypto assets. There are also some trading and operational differences between CeFi and DeFi exchanges as well. For instance, as we just pointed out, a centralized exchange has an order book that shows the price that buyers want to buy and sellers want to sell. Decentralized exchanges don't have such a centralized order book and instead rely on an innovative mechanism that involves what we call automatic market makers, often abbreviated to AMMs, and liquidity providers. The concept of AMM really gained popularity in the summer of 2020 with the rise of the decentralized exchange Uniswap, although other exchanges had pioneered before. In short, AMMs allows anyone, anywhere, to trade certain crypto assets but without a centralized intermediary. Instead of using a traditional order book or traditional market makers, AMMs use liquidity pools. And liquidity pools operate in a very clever way. For example, each liquidity pool is a trading venue for a pair of tokens, and anyone can create a liquidity pool for a new pair of tokens. This is very different from a centralized exchange, where you need to go through approval lists, following a listing process, and very often, high listing fees. When a liquidity pool contract is created, the balance of each token are zero, but anyone can become a liquidity provider and deposit an equal value of both tokens into the pool. For example, if there's a trading pair of ETH and USDC, then all you need to do is to deposit an equal value of ETH and USDC in the liquidity pool. In exchange, you receive a percentage of the trading fees in the liquidity pool, basically acting like a market maker, but in a decentralized exchange. Now, what is really interesting is that various actors around the industry have actually been trying to combine the best of two worlds, mixing the strongest aspects of centralized and decentralized finance together. For example, some DeFi platforms like Aave have begun trying to launch institutional-grade platforms where users need to pass KYC and AML checks before being able to trade. That gives traders the benefits of DeFi, but with the certainty that they're trading only with known counterparties that have passed compliance checks. Or Bullish, for full disclosure, a sponsor of some of my educational content, which takes the benefits of DeFi and adds the regulatory compliance framework of a centralized exchange. Bullish is very interesting, as it conducts KYC on all its clients and offers customer support, but leverages a liquidity pool mechanism similar to a DeFi exchange, thus trying to provide the benefits of DeFi and CeFi, but without the downside. Other centralized exchanges have also been trying to see if they can play a role and provide a gateway to DeFi services. For example, could a user of a big centralized exchange use the KYC information provided during the onboarding process to also prove their identity on a DeFi exchange? But regulators and policymakers have also been looking at the space. For example, the FATF, the Financial Action Task Force, which is a global money laundering and terrorist financial watchdog, has mentioned that DeFi platforms will need to eventually be regulated. Ultimately, both CeFi and DeFi will continue to exist side by side, with each serving its own market and customer base. But as we've seen, innovation around the crypto space occurs at a rapid pace, meaning more and more aspects and features of DeFi could eventually find their way into CeFi and vice versa. So this is an area of crypto ecosystem that is definitely worth following. Hope this was a useful video. What do you think? Are we going to see DeFi and CeFi converge? We'll love to hear your thoughts. If there's any other topic you'd like me to cover in a future explainer video, feel free to let me know in the comments below. Thank you and see you all soon.